Honored to have you with us in the 8 p.m. edition of The Urban Debate. Social media giant Facebook, that recently changed its entire name to Meta, is under the scanner constantly these days in one or the other part of the world for its, what many say, failure to contain and stop, block, remove misinformation and hate speech on its platform. In fact, the bigger problem being that many indicate that the platform knowingly allows or turns a blind eye to this big problem. Now, while Facebook constantly and vehemently denies why it is in limelight yet again, is the internal reports that are coming to light is often how whistleblowers, Facebook's own insiders, researchers who come out and speak in documents that come into the public domain that raise these very important questions. And tonight we're going to talk about it. We're going to talk about the fact that there is no denying that fake news, misinformation, most importantly, hate content thrives on social media platform. And at what point and how will we make these social media platforms accountable for it, especially if there are indications that they knowingly are not doing enough to stop it. These internal reports are part of documents disclosed to United States Security and Exchange Commission, or SEC as it's known as, and have also been provided to the Congress in US in a redacted form by the legal counsel of a former Facebook employee and whistleblower, Francis Haugen. Now, the redacted versions received by Congress have been reviewed by a consortium of global news organizations, including the Indian Express here in India, and they have been putting out a series of these stories. So you would have read some of them that have come to the fore just in the last few weeks. There's an instance that has come to the fore about how a Facebook's own researcher actually set up a test account in India. And this happened in 2019. They set up a test account to see what is it that Facebook feeds them as content to be consumed. In 3 weeks, the feed was filled with fake news, to the point that there was a group called Things That Make You Laugh that also included fake news posts. This was reported by the Business Standard. Then there was the instance that about the Wall Street Journal releasing a report that that FB had identified anti-Muslim hate speech propaganda pages and groups after the CEA protests began here in India. This report actually talks about how inflammatory content spiked over 300% after December 2019. This is when the anti-CEA protests had just begun, peaking towards February when it led to riots as well in the national capital. This was also reported by various organizations. Then there is a report admitted that Facebook's artificial intelligence is not able to identify the vernacular posts, that they haven't invested enough money into tracking posts which are in regional languages beyond a couple of Indian regional languages. And so a faulty artificial intelligence is failing to identify a lot of this hate content and misinformation that exists. So what is it that we are really talking about tonight? We're talking about a series of reports that have emerged that indicate that Facebook was allegedly aware of the harmful posts and didn't do enough to stop it, that it even hesitated and often to designate certain groups and users of certain groups and thought processes as dangerous, that not enough resources are actually being spent in India for sensitive issues. Case in point, it is reported that 87% of the budget is actually for United States and the rest for the rest of the world. And that's how less is being spent in resources to stop this kind of content, to contain it and remove it. And repeatedly, these instances come out. So, how do we deal with this is the question I'm asking tonight. Hemchand Sharma of the Delhi BJP, member of the BJP National IT Campaign Committee in 2019, joins me this evening. Rohan Gupta of the Congress Party, Rahul Narayan, advocate with the Supreme Court, NS Napinai, advocate with the Supreme Court and a cyber law expert, Kanish Gaur, founder of the India Future Foundation, and Dr. Pawan Duggal, cyber law expert, also joining me this evening. Let me start off with NS Napinai. it's not a new conversation. Of course, we've often debated it, but in the light of lot more evidence coming out, which indicates, social media platforms essentially knowing what's going on and not doing enough to stop it. How would you say we go about designing any kind of legal framework to deal with this, or should we just leave it?
Tanvi, the issue really is on how do we enforce a legal framework which is already there. If you look at Section 79, which everybody speaks about, the safe harbor provision for social media platforms, it comprises under Section 79(3) subclause B, a very specific clause which says that an intermediary will not be liable if upon actual knowledge, and I pause there before I move on to say the other part of Section 79(3)(b) talks about being informed by government, etc., etc. But the first part of it is if upon actual knowledge. So all the details which you just set out in terms of having knowledge of fake news and not doing anything about it, the issue then that will arise is to what extent can Facebook or any other social media platform be held liable even under the existing framework? What is it that we have done to even evaluate the implications of this wording of actual knowledge? In the Shreya Singhal's judgment, the only thing that the Supreme Court said was that actual knowledge does not amount to users informing you. And therefore, they set aside that one part of the rules and said that it has to be based on a court order or a government order. Now, the issue that arises in the context of what is happening with this kind of rampant fake news and hate speech, more importantly, which is causing harm to the extent of loss of life, one needs to evaluate how can existing law, because if you're going to talk about evolving laws, it takes a lot of time. It's glacial. We need to figure out how can we implement what is there today. And does it need a relook, therefore, of the executive action, which is framing of rules under Section 79, which was what was done by the government in the context of various other things, but not sufficiently probably in terms of fake news or hate speech. So is there something that can be built further on the foundation of the parent law that is existing already? That is something I think we need to evaluate. And as we have discussed, we have already talked about the evolving AI solutions, including in terms of creating word banks, etc., for in vernacular language for combating offenses against women and children. That may be another solution which can be expanded to also meet the requirements of fake news and hate speech.
Okay. So in the existing framework, Rahul Narayan, how much... to what extent do we make the platforms and can we make the platforms accountable? And to what extent is the role of the law enforcement agency in our country? I mean, can the government ask and force and push social media giants to invest more so that they're able to tackle this better?
Is to look at this. Firstly, I mean, of course, I completely agree with Ms. Napinai, who spoke before me, that has to be the correct way. The law already exists and we have to find a way to implement it. And no one can say that you shouldn't implement your law. But let me put it like this. I have some sympathy for the argument that it may be technically very difficult to do so. Yeah. And that the way to do it might not be, you might not find an answer for 100% today. You have to be able to take what you get right now and move on and ensure that the process gets better. But what I am not sympathetic about is if people know about something which is wrong and they refuse to take any action whatsoever. Like, I think it's fairly well known that India must be one of the largest markets for Facebook. In that case, the failure to invest enough to have sufficient people familiar with various vernacular languages, whether Hindi or Bengali, that is unforgivable. It's one thing to say that, you know, we are a organization that believes in free speech, and therefore for us to be able to censor something beforehand is dangerous or not correct, or not according to our philosophy, not right. And secondly, of course, the fact that, you know, one person's hate speech could be another person's free speech. So there is a line over there which has to be drawn by somebody. I can understand if issues arising out of that cause some pause. And like I said, like Ms. Tapan said before me, maybe there is some artificial intelligence solution which works to some extent. Although one has to be very careful over here, you know, like the line between hate speech and what is legitimate political speech may be very small in many cases. Although, of course, frankly, considering the WhatsApp message which all of us have received and the Facebook post which all of us have seen, for some of them, there is literally no excuse why they were not banned in the first place. So like I said, for this, there is a technical problem. And I think that maybe the organizations themselves, people like Facebook, Meta, whatever, can collaborate with the government and find newer and better tools to deal with it. But secondly, as far as, you know, the existing framework is concerned, they have to find a way to implement the law, and the government and the country has every right to enforce these laws. So as far as the 79 bit is concerned, as far as, you know, they better invest in people who can do more fact checking for them in terms of vernacular language. That is no excuse that we don't have enough people speaking Bengali there.
Yeah, I mean, they've not even set it up for several of these regional languages, and there are specific instances, you know, just to add to the point that Rahul was making, so specific instances that now have come out in these documents and disclosures that give examples of how an incident in Kashmir actually led to violence and a whole series of fake news, propaganda, hate content being shared on Facebook. And a lot of it was viewed by people in the Bengali language, and which obviously fell out of the Facebook's purview because they don't have the AI to even filter that or go through it. That's the kind of challenge we are looking at right now. Let me actually now go across to some of our political panelists before I bring in our other experts. Rohan, it's extremely important right now that governments and political parties also keep up with the changes on the digital platforms and ensure that a lot of this content is removed, because every now and then we hear about law enforcement agencies blaming real incidents of violence, you know, crime that's taking place on fake social media posts. And a lot of it seems to be stemming from what is online and what people are consuming on Twitter, Facebook, WhatsApp.
And see, Facebook is one of the biggest social media players as far as India is concerned. When 34 crore people are there on particular platform, it is their responsibility. They cannot come with the lame excuse that they do not have budgets to analyze the content. And we are a sensitive country. And the way before Lok Sabha elections, Facebook allowed it to be misused by the ruling party, it was quite evident. And Tanvi, you know that we have raised this issue a number of times. One of the senior executives of Facebook was sacked after that. And even then, it was their internal safety committee's report was ignored by their security committee. There were hate pages which were flagged by their internal team. They were not removed. So even if they were flagged and they were not removed, forget about artificial intelligence. So I think Facebook has allowed themselves to be used as puppet by ruling party as far as the elections are concerned. And even after that, there are a lot of instances where the whistleblowers have raised these issues, that even if they have raised the issues, no action has been taken. Tanvi, this cannot happen like that. For the company like Facebook, they have their internal systems. Everything is in place. And still in countries like India, which are very, very sensitive, if these kind of things are allowed, I think they have allowed them to be used by BJP. And even just 4 days back, I've written a letter to the owner of the Facebook regarding the same, asking for the internal inquiry. And Tanvi, there have been a lot of issues coming every day. The reports are coming. You tell me what action is taken by Facebook. They are admitting that, yes, there was an error by them. They ignored the reports and all. You tell me what inquiry Facebook has conducted and what they have come out. They are answerable to the people of India. They have to apologize that, yes, we allowed our platform to be misused, and we apologize for that, and future it will not happen. It is a matter of trust of 30 crore people, 34 crore people of India. Tanvi, it's not a small thing.
Of course, what you're saying in the Facebook is answerable for that and must explain this to people. But let me give you one example, Rohan. And this is what has come out in the Indian Express today as part of the documents that they have looked at, released internationally. There was actually a research done by Facebook, one of their own internal research that was done, posts that were flagged by Facebook researchers, communal violence and vigilante violence against students in Delhi, violence surrounding citizenship law protests in Lucknow, violence targeting North Indian migrants in Mumbai, and antagonisms related to religion, Bangladeshi migrants in Kolkata were among the salient conflicts that was flagged off by the Facebook researchers from posts and sites that they focused on in terms of the Indian geography and key cities in India. And they then made a memo out of it. They made a research memo and they actually found very interesting details where they said there was a significant amount of content. City-wise conflicts grid also noted that participants surveyed during the site visits reported demonizing anti-Muslim content connected to CAA protests and Delhi riots. That they also said approximately 1 in 3 users of the Facebook family of apps, which is Facebook, Facebook Messenger, and WhatsApp and Instagram, surveyed, reported seeing inflammatory content. So to the point that Rohan is making about what do? They did do this research according to the Indian Express report. Their own researchers looked at the content 1 month before and after the anti-CA protests and the riots in that period. And then there were also recommendations made, but reportedly, none of those recommendations have been implemented. It was recommended that you put out reporting categories, which has not been rolled out. Hate, inflammatory, misinformation, violence, incitement. Categorize it like this, even for WhatsApp content, which has not been rolled out. The research suggested understanding platforms' impact on vulnerable groups, which has not been done. The role of WhatsApp and Facebook groups formed by rioters also came under lens. So there is definitely some amount of accountability. Knowing that this is what is happening on your platform, what are you doing about it? And who can make them answer that? Khemchand Sharma, who can make them answer that? Okay, we seem to have lost that line with Khemchand Sharma of the BJP. I'm going to try and go back to him. But Kanishk, let me bring that point to you. Who can make the social media giants give us answers for these issues?
So I think the government can make them actionable. They can make the government do more about this. The intermediary laws, the guidelines which came was a step in this direction, which will make significant social media giants liable in terms of whatever information is floating on these platforms. And I believe that we need to have a stronger regulatory mechanism, one for tracking it and also for taking down this kind of content. We have seen that the laws came into the picture, but the main aspect lies in implementing them and also a government watchdog constantly watching them in terms of telling them that this is the kind of hate messaging, fake news, which is perpetrating in the social media platform. And mind you, this is not just say about Facebook or WhatsApp. It's a problem across social media, which is for all different significant social media giants, because so far we have seen that political parties have been investing heavily on fake news, on misinformation to serve their interests. So it is also accountability of the political parties in terms of their IT cells, what kind of messaging they want to send out. Do they want to use fake news and misinformation to win elections or to influence particular sects of society, or do they want to create a more positive environment within the country? So these are some of the aspects which must be taken into consideration. And it is not just say about one political party, it is about multiple political parties, because these political parties also have invested heavily on social media platforms. They have been hiring external experts for using algorithm, using artificial intelligence. So this problem is here to stay, and the government must have stronger norms. The delay in the privacy bill is acting on this further, because you know we don't know how privacy of Indian consumers are getting breached, how my metadata is getting used today, right? Will that be used for pushing specific content on me by a specific group or a community? If I belong to a specific set of the society, the content that I watch on social media, would that be controlled? Is there a strong bias? Those are bigger questions which come into the picture. And this is not just happening in India. It is happening overall. So India today has to look at creating more measures. You look at Facebook, they have taken maximum amount of efforts in the United States. because the government there acted strongly.
Correct.
Government acted strongly. Our government kept on sitting for 2 years. Our intermediary laws came into the picture when WhatsApp's encryption policy, when WhatsApp's privacy policy came into the picture. After that, we reacted and we said we will give 3 months time for the intermediary laws to be implemented within this country. So we have to keep one step ahead of these social media giants, and the government must act in a better manner and understand the kind of risk it can posture specifically in India, which is one of the largest democracies.
Yes, absolutely. You pointed out a very interesting aspect. Pawan Duggal, let me come to you on that. The fact that the way they function in the United States is very different from the way they function here in terms of taking things seriously. I'll add to what Kanishk was saying. The Delhi Assembly wanted to, summon them, ask them questions. It took them a really long time, over a year, to get to that point because the Facebook officials refused to appear before the Delhi Assembly, saying, "We don't have to." It became a big legal fight. Today was finally the first meeting that actually took place where questions have been asked by the chairman of that committee about hate speech. What are you doing about hate speech? They've asked them to submit all the content-related reports that they have for 1 month prior and 2 months after the Delhi riots. But essentially, shouldn't this be what our governments need to be doing a lot more to make these platforms accountable? Will that work?
The time has come where the platforms cannot be allowed to be mute spectator while mayhem happens on their network. Well, we have to understand there's a fundamental difference. The US law gives them absolute immunity under Section 230 of the Communications Decency Act for liability for any third-party data. Basically, US law says, guys, you are only pipe providers. So we are not going to make you liable for what flows through. But the Indian approach on intermediary liability is slightly more nuanced. We say, by and large, we don't make you liable for third-party data, provided you fulfill certain conditions. You comply with the Information Technology Act and rules and regulations. You exercise due diligence while you discharge your obligations under the law. You do not conspire or abet in the commission of any offense. And once the government calls upon you to remove or disable access, you do the same without vitiating the original electronic record. But that's a law that we actually implemented way back in the amendments to the IT Act in 2008. However, this law has never been effectively implemented till today. So there's been a great honeymoon of the intermediaries that's been going on from 2008 till 2021 February. It's only that the IT rules 2021, which came in February, changed the landscape and make them criminally liable. Now, it's important to note that service providers cannot have the luxury to say, I'm going to close my eyes, I'm going to let my network and my platform be misused for cyber criminal or other illegal or criminal purposes, and yet I will continue to be completely immune from any legal exposure. For that, political will is required. So what the Delhi government or the Delhi Assembly has done today is something that every governmental officer, every governmental agency ought to have done it. More so because after the IT rules 2021, they are now going to be criminally liable if they do not really comply with the provisions of the IT Act and the IT rules. And that could mean two kinds of things. The Suraksha Kavach, the statutory exemption from legal liability that's given to them under Section 79 of the IT Act, that's going to be taken away from them by operation of law. And number two, they become liable for criminal consequences. This is actually now the need of the hour because there's so much of hangama happening on these platforms. There's so much of hate news, fake news, all kinds of terror and other related cybercriminal activities. Let's remember, we are now in the golden age of cybercrime, which has actually begun with the coming of the COVID-19 times. So now the responsibility and accountability of the service providers and intermediaries in these changed digital ecosystem becomes even more paramount. But for that, I think, number one, we require more political will in the country to implement whatever existing law is there. And number two, I think we need to go in the direction of the Christchurch Declaration post the Christchurch attacks and make more and more responsibility and accountability out of these service providers, because you cannot really go ahead and offer your services of a country of 1+ billion people and then say, I'm not going to be amenable to your law. You will have to comply with Indian law. Compliance with Indian law is not a luxury. It's a mandatory feature before you are able to get the benefits of the Indian ecosystem and the Indian market. That has to be the message that's to be given loud and clear to the service providers.
So I think largely everybody so far has been, all the experts are, you know, in agreement of the fact that one, a basic framework exists. It's a matter of implementation and how you go about it, and that can be the challenge. Two, yes, it is, government has a larger role to play here in making these platforms accountable. Yes, I believe Mr. Khemchand Sharma is with us now. Go ahead, please.
Absolutely, government has a larger role to play, and this government, fortunately, is doing that. This government has come up with a framework, IT laws and recommendations, which each and every company has to follow, and they cannot like avoid it. Earlier, we know how the Facebook. Not only the social media, also the important issues of our data, and they also try to set their narratives. But now, the Modi government has clearly communicated to everybody: you have to adhere to the law of the land. If you do not, then you will have to face the actions. Just like Twitter has had to face the actions, and many complaints against the Twitter failed because Twitter had some kind of the protection from the government, which was withdrawn. Because Twitter was not supporting or adhering to the IT guidelines. So now we are towards the betterment, towards the what our country needed. And I'm sure in coming times, we'll be in a better position. Still, there are the problems. There are the issues against the, like child abuses, child, you can say, sex videos are also on a social media sites or on a digital sites. So
Mr. Khemchand Sharma, can you give me examples of what the government has done that has brought about any changes in the way Facebook functions in the last 1 year, 2 years, even in the last 2 months? Explain to me how.
So the most important thing is now all social media handles or platforms now has appointed the grievance officers. So whomsoever, like now the users can approach to the grievance officer, and the grievance officer has to reply and sort out the problem logically in a time frame. Earlier, like they could suspend the account, there was litigation, and users just had no choice and could not get their account revived in the terms of the money, but they were having no support. Now there is a support. And we can see the visible impact also. So whatever the account is getting wrongly.
Okay, we're going to try and fix that network with you, and maybe hopefully have a better feed such that I can understand fully what you're saying, Mr. Sharma. But since you've mentioned the rules and the guidelines that have been brought in and how they are having an impact, let me ask the experts, Rahul, how much of an impact? I mean, I understand if it's a grievance redressal system where if my account has been blocked, I have a person to go to or a platform to go to and explain my case. But how does that help us tackle fake news and hate speech? As recently as last week, we were told that a lot of the violence that unfolded in Tripura and Maharashtra was because of this kind of fake news.
Brings us back to this entire discussion, brings us back to what I was starting with, a kind of nuanced thing. Now, I certainly agree that the intermediate guidelines are a step forward, but they're also not necessarily the best things going. There are plenty of things to criticize in the things as well. Because you see, there is a very, we all of us as consumers are stuck between the devil and the deep sea. We don't want social media companies to control us, but also we don't want the government to control it either. The point is free speech, which is permissible, but we don't want anybody telling us what to do. The entire point, you can say, of free speech means nobody can tell me what I should print or what I should publish. I should be allowed to say what I want. The point being, when I say something bad or when I say something illegal, the actions naturally follow. So to that extent, it's very easy to say that, that there can be a huge amount of government interference. But that also is not a good thing for a democracy at all. So to that extent, there is a problem there. And even about the Facebook case in Supreme Court about the summons and their presence, etc. I mean, we may think that, you know, in the long run, of course, social media should definitely be accountable to the political branches. But there was actually a serious issue of parliamentary privilege as well. It's a different issue of constitutional law, so I won't get into that over here. But it wasn't completely without merit. There was a certain issue which had to be decided by the court over there as well. So, you know, we are, like I said, we are in a very complicated and difficult position.
Yeah.
It's very easy to say that, you know, the government can do this and the government can do that. I think the government should be very careful about what it wants to do. And social media has to also be very careful. Everyone over here says that social media should control what people say. But the simple fact is that social media, if Facebook were to read every message which I write, or if WhatsApp were to look at every message, then I would not like that either, right? We keep talking about privacy against social media as well. So the fact is that, you know, when the intermediary guidelines impact things like end-to-end user encryption, that also has its own dangers. So the point is, you know, and as far as fake news and misinformation is concerned, I don't think that the social media, the new rules are particularly effective. But then again, like I said, it is very difficult to find things which are particularly effective. And one last thing I wanted to end with is what Mr. Gore's excellent point about how political parties must control the people who work for them as well. The simple truth is, you know, you can blame guns for all kinds of mass shootings, but the person shooting behind also has some level of responsibility. So if our political parties and if our leaders can be held accountable for the actions of their followers, if they can, like, for example, political parties in this country have to follow the diktats of the Election Commission and they have to comply with the framework of our constitution. Similarly, if we can get our political parties to declare that some speech is simply beyond bounds, and ensure that their followers do not spread this kind of speech, that may be, in effect, a little more effective way to go about it.
Okay.
Rather than only filing on social media.
You know, you've raised a very beautiful nuance that needs to be discussed. And I don't think there's an easy answer to this, but much can be debated, Ms. Nappanai, about the extent of government's role and the apprehension that comes along with it of overreach by the government then.
The perfect segue to what I wanted to say, actually, Tanvi, which is that it is really important for social media platforms to wake up and to take their roles very seriously, you know, the responsibilities very seriously. There have been recent reports, one in the context of the new social media law that the government is proposing, and also in the context of the JPC committee's responses in terms of data protection, where there has been murmurs about treating social media platforms as publishers. Imagine the kind of impact that will have on social media platforms. They will simply not be able to function if something like that were to come forward. All of this is being mandated because of this kind of rampant misuse which we are seeing, including in terms of inaction. So here is the word of caution I wanted to end on to say that it is important, one, for the government to seek that utopian balance, and so also for social media platforms to understand their responsibility and ensure better implementation mechanisms, failing which they are going to face much more stringent laws, which are just going to then probably be the death knell for them. And I don't think any of us really want that. So.
Okay. So three categories that now we're looking at. One, the social media platforms themselves. Two, the government. And three, of course, political parties and their supporters and backers and the groups that thereby exist and what they do on the social media platform. Two people wanted to make points. First, to Kanishk Kaur and then to Khemchand Sharma. Yes, Kanishk.
I think very important also to look at that during the election period, we see a lot of surge in activity, especially on social media. While there are regulations in terms of how political parties are supposed to behave on ground and stop the campaign 48 hours before the actual election happens. But on social media, the activity continues. And there are no norms in India which prevent any political party from putting any kind of hate messaging, inciting violence, or also putting fake news or misinformation. We have seen that misinformation, election interference is a reality. US and some of the other countries have already, you know, seen all of this happening in their countries.
it's time that India also looks at some of these aspects seriously, and you look at social media seriously, and you have more norms around in terms of what kind of behavior political parties can put up on social media platform. Can that be misused for, you know, inciting violence? That's a very important point that we need to address. The other part is all social media platforms, including Facebook, Twitter, or WhatsApp, need to come up with their programs on how they will promote more acceptance of any kind of fake news or misinformation or more trust. I believe Facebook has already started one program called as the Trust and Safety Program, through which they are trying to work with a lot of civil society organizations, but they have to do more. And similarly, other platforms, including WhatsApp, Twitter, they also need to do more about this, because they have to build up the trust with the end user. Because tomorrow, if that's not there, we will just see that whatever is coming to us is controlled by an external party, not only within India, but it could be also from somewhere outside.
Well, what you're saying about the initiatives that they are taking is true. But I think it's far, far, far away from what is required. And I will go back to some of the statistics that have just emerged in the recent reports that say that only 0.2% of the reported hate speech is actually taken down by automated checks. According to the document cited, which also flags the lack of language classifiers, which will be able to check for translations as well. So out of the 22 officially recognized languages in our country, and most of the social media giants have begun to, you know, allow you to use these languages on their platforms, they have AIs or artificial intelligence filters only for 5 of these languages. Rest are still manually done. And even in that, they haven't put up enough investment to even stop a percentage of the content that's going on. So that's where we stand right now. Khemchand Sharma wanted to make a point. And to you and then to Rohan, I also want to ask about, what about the responsibility of larger political groups themselves about how you misuse or abuse the system?
First of all, I would like to say sorry, there was some internet problem, so I could not make my point earlier better. There are two, three things. One is like freedom of speech. Because social media user want the freedom of speech, whatever they want to say, whatever they want to write, whatever they want to say, they can say clearly. So that is what social media users like, love, and that's what they are doing. And that is why the social media become popular, and social media become, compulsion for each and every youth in the world. And the second thing comes, then fake news and the misinformation campaign. So now the duty of the social media handles, or you can say technology platforms, comes because they have to control the fake news, they have to control the negative narrative making, they have to control the hate speeches, and they have to control also the crime, or you can say sex videos or contents against the women and the child. So that is where the government and social media platform has to work more and more. Earlier, there was no such a law or such a framework which could control these platforms or these companies. So they were almost free, and they were misusing our data, and they were manipulating everything. Now, the government of India has come up with a new IT guidelines and made each and every platform responsible. And that is changing a lot now. The misinformation will also get controlled, because now the people can report. If I'm writing something which is not liked by you, you can report. And the grievance officer has to evaluate and give the answer. If that comes under the category of fake news or misinformation or narrative, you can say negative narrative setting, then they can delete it, they can change it, or they can ask me to remove it. But earlier, this system was not there. So now what I feel, slowly we are moving towards what we needed, but still a lot of work need to be done, and we have to, like, collectively all technocrats also pitch in and work, and we have to continuously make a pressure on these platforms. And another thing is, we have to ask government who have an alternative, so we have people can chat, people can share their thought, and people can also contact to the government. So that is what it is happening. So now what I feel, the combination of the indigenous platform and the rural regulations and continuously watch will make this platform or technology better for us.
Okay, interesting that you mentioned the indigenous platforms, because at the end of the day, it's allowing content, fake news, hate speech, divisive content, misleading content on the platforms, and holding those platforms accountable irrespective of who they are, which is important. Now, an example after example has come out of Facebook in the recent past. The government and the various ministers in the government have made tall claims of how they're going to, you know, summon the Facebook officials, make them accountable, ask them these questions, ask them to explain. None of that has actually happened. And like our experts are pointing out, the existing guidelines don't really give us too much space for a transparent way of doing that, actually. There is no transparent way of us, the government's being able to do that right now. Rohan Gupta, how do we deal with it then?
See, Tanvi, whichever is the country, whatever the rules, what is...
Mr. Sharma, I'll come back to you. Yeah. Rohan, go ahead.
What everything depends on which is the ruling party, right? Now, in our country, see, this is not a political debate that I wanted to make this point. It depends on the ideology of the party. We see that last 2 years, what's happening with Facebook, where the hate content or fake news or these kind of things were allowed. Who gets benefit, political benefit out of it? It's a ruling party. And 2019, we have seen the Pulwama incident. We saw that there were internal reports saying people saw more and more Pulwama incident photographs than any other photographs. And if the government is silent on that, that clearly means that it is intentional. So what I'm trying to tell is it purely depends on the ruling party in any country, what is their ideology. And in countries like India, which is very, very sensitive, Facebook, which considers India one of the biggest markets, and if they are not ready to spend money, it clearly shows how serious they are. So I don't feel that this is unintentional. This is purely, purely intentional under the pressure of ruling party that Facebook has acted irresponsibly, and now these things are coming on surface. Every day new report is coming, and we are not going to leave it that. It's a responsibility of a platform to ensure that it is not misused by anybody. I'm saying whether it is Congress, BJP, anybody. It cannot be allowed to be misused in countries like us.
Okay. Yes, Kemchand Sharma says it's wrong. Please tell me how.
Yeah, I'm shocked like Indians to condemn the Pulwama attack and condemn the Pakistan. Why don't you mention that Twitter as well as the Facebook platforms were manipulating, the narrative was manipulating. Both Pakistan
and trending into the India. Please hold. I did not disturb you. Please hold. What I said. So you wanted to restrict those content and that narrative and discussions. No, brother, we cannot. Because freedom of speech and the normal content, normal discussion has to be go. But the misinformation campaign should stop. The narrative building from outside of the country should stop, which happened in the past. There was no framework. It was continued. And these platforms were not adhering to our laws and cooperating with the government or agencies. But now they have to, and they have started doing it. Government had clearly told them, clearly made them to do what our nation needed. Now they have a grievance officer. Now they have a local offices. Now they are responsible. If they do not...
Okay, so explain to me this, Mr. Kemchand Sharma, since you believe that these new guidelines are actually the solution of the problems we are discussing here. I am citing now from the latest report that has emerged, which said that the inflammatory content on Facebook spiked 300% above the previous levels during the times as the anti-CA protests started spreading in our country, December 2019 onwards. And this went on till June. This is a report of July 2020 that says that the Facebook inflammatory content spiked. That's the time there was highly polarizing conversation going on in our country. That's also the time that we saw a series of riots take place in our country. We saw multiple clashes take place in our country. Now tell me, in the current guidelines, how would you make Facebook accountable for it?
Because Facebook has to make sure the external sources or external handles, whosoever is trying to make their narrative or narrative against the country, they have to cooperate with the agency. They'll have to tell
from where, what is the source, from where the content are coming. And they have to also put an AI, artificial intelligence, as well as off, offline team to check the content and to whether it is against or mis- supporting terrorism, supporting crime, supporting or initiating any side of any kind of the riots. So they will have to put a team. So now the agency will ask the information and they will like to tell the source from where it has been started. Earlier, they were not sharing the source. They were not telling who started and why started.
Then it comes back to the point that Rohan was actually, the Congress party was trying to make, that it really depends on what the ruling party of the country wants.
They are thinking with a biased mindset. What they did? Why they did not start it? Like industry or these technology giant or technology platforms got developed during their government only. They could start some framework. Why they do not? Because they cannot think for future. They cannot think futuristic. They were just busy into their corruption or their internal problems. This government can think for next 20 years, 30 years, and 50 years. Now we are talking about the data. Now we are trying to save our data. They have sold everything. They had no control over these companies or these platforms. Now we are planning. Now we are trying to bring everything into the framework or into the system. Because it may take a time because we are already...
I agree with you that you are. And of course, miles ahead of what was being done or even thought of earlier. I have complete agreement on that. But it's the debate right now, Mr. Pawan Duggal, is in the way that it's being done. Does it give too much power then onto the ruling party? And if things
there's no power. Everything is recorded. The ruling power, ruling government cannot manipulate. These companies are independent companies. If government has something to do, they will make official requests and official requests will get recorded. So nobody can manipulate. Let me tell you, even the Congress before the 2019 election, they had association with the Facebook and they used the data. They misused the data with the Cambridge Analytica. Everybody right. knows it because they had a system. And they had
of which also nothing came out, has come out of even now. For all the tall claims that were made about making people accountable for what happened with Facebook and Cambridge Analytica, nothing has come out as far as government action is concerned. But I want to go back to a point that was raised here by some of our experts, Mr. Pawan Duggal, which is the existing guidelines. Some amount of good that they do bring in, but where is it that they are lacking that we need to look at?
Clearly, the lacking portion is that there is too much of power in the hands of the government.
Yeah.
So that's one area that which can potentially be gone ahead and misused or used in any particular manner because the relevant balancing factors are non-existent. For example, when you look at the IT rules 2021, it says that, look, as a service provider, please give me the details of the origin of the concerned message or the person who's done it. You don't give me that, I'm going to not only strip you of your statutory exemption from legal liability, I'm also going to press criminal charges against you. Now, this kind of a game plan was not existent either under the IT Act or under the IT Rules 2011. This particular new color only started coming in February 2021 under the IT Rules. So technically, it's possible for any government of the day, whatever the government may be, to follow the mandate under the IT Rules and start criminal prosecution of the service providers. And that's one area that service providers are very jittery about. Well, as of now, we've only seen one documented case where four FIRs have been registered against Twitter on its failure to comply with the IT rules 2021. And that's why it now has to face criminal exposure. Now, imagine if that starts getting replicated across the board on various service providers. The kind of chilling effect it could potentially have is a very important issue that needs to be considered. However, having said that, you just cannot say that, look, the service providers can hide behind the so-called cloak of encryption and say, I'm end-to-end encrypted and I will not give you information. Sorry, if you're targeting India, you have no choices but to give information in pursuance of a legitimate request. Mind you, the government is not asking all kinds of information about all kinds of users. It's only asking information pertaining to either misuse or abuse or the criminal activities done under the law. And if that's a legal process that you're asked to do, you can't slap that particular process by saying that I am actually bound down by the end-to-end encryption and my privacy pouch that I've, or the promise that I've given to my citizens, my users, and that's why I'm not going to give information. So somewhere down the line, the messaging has to go along. But I still feel the balancing factors, the checks and balances which are required under the IT rules are clearly missing. And the quicker we are able to beef them up under the IT rules and make them more workable, the better it will be. But having said that, the service providers and intermediaries have to realize there are only one portion of the IT rules which have been stayed by certain courts. The remaining portion, which specifically pertain to intermediaries, specifically rule 3, 4, 5, 6, are not being stayed, which means that they are law of the land. And if you don't comply with this, your statutory exemption is automatically stripped off by operation of law. So you have a choice. You can either play with fire and say, look, I'm going to face the consequences, or it'll be better to be going ahead and being on the side of caution rather than to repent later at a later point of time.
Okay, fair enough. Kanish, do you want to weigh in on this?
Can I make a quick comment, Pigoch?
Yeah, Kemchand, I'll come to you in just a bit. Yeah.
So, I think the important point here is that the current intermediary guidelines, they need further modifications. There are aspects which require further clearance, right? If you look at the kind of news which is originating from outside, but is coming through an international number, how do you track that international number if that person is still here in India, right? Finding out who's the first originator of message or fake news or misinformation is an important aspect. Another aspect is the standard operating procedures, the SOPs, the way the intermediary guidelines will be implemented. Those require further inputs to be done. So I think the law in the current shape requires more modifications to be made more implementable on ground right now. And the current shape where it is in, there are a lot of lacunas which needs to be further streamlined to make it more effective. These are some of the aspects. We have also seen that traceability and metadata, which is there, which can also lead to surveillance, right? So if you are saying that government has too much of power on its side, it can also track down and trace every message which is happening on social media platform. So it can create some kind of a bias of people who are speaking against the government and misused against them. It could be by launching FIR against them or even, you know, misrepresenting what they are trying to say. And we have seen some of these cases which have happened, and Mr. Pawan Dugal has highlighted some of those cases. So those are aspects which must be taken into consideration so that we don't get into a surveillance state kind of a mechanism where every text message sent by an Indian citizen is being tracked by the government and then it is being looked at in a mirror saying, is it against the government or is it anti-national or is it against the current ruling party? That is a very important aspect that must be taken into account. And that is clearly aspect with respect to freedom of speech, but in a manner that people are able to say what they want. Right? And You are still able to control misinformation and fake news.
Well, some amount of transparency is also needed, right? The only way that apprehension can actually be addressed is if there is transparency in what the government seeks as action from these platforms and how much of that is actually done by the platforms for us to be able to maybe find that trust. Kemchand Sharma wanted to make a point. Yes, go ahead, please.
The transparency is concerned. This government is completely transparent. And as far as the law are concerned, it's an incremented process. We are not closed. We are open for the incremented updation, incremented modification, incremented betterment. That will make us perfect. And that is the way of doing anything. And that is the way of becoming expert in IT also. I'm an IT guy. Another thing, as far as surveillance is concerned, do you know, America do the surveillance on each and every message which is going through their platforms or their companies. There are the examples. They track through their AI. And whenever they encounter such words, such messages, such format, they interrupt, their agency interrupt. Another thing is about the India. In India, we have a full-fledged system. Nobody is surveillanced. And no one, even the Prime Minister, cannot ask or cannot order some for few guys or few people or few, groups to get them surveillanced. There is a system. Agency will trigger the flag and appropriate officer, senior officer will make a request and it will be recorded. That request will go to the platforms and platforms will have to help because we have to save our country. And it's a huge matter. The people, because of the encryption, they are talking like even the terrorists are talking and they are doing too many illegal activities. Mm. So at some level, surveillance support for the agency is also required. That is a necessary thing.
Yeah, nobody's That's arguing on that at all, Mr. Kemchand Sharma. I don't think we're going down that road tonight at least.
We're not
arguing about the legitimate needs for surveillance. It's the unabashed and, without and checks and balance surveillance and the possibility of that has to be kept in mind. And you talk about checks and balances there.
No, I can guarantee on your TV there's no issues.
Yeah, but, verbal guarantees from anybody within the establishment of the ruling party or any political party does very little with any of us. We would want to see actual physical evidence of it in terms of action taken.
This is a system which apply on all. The politician doesn't execute the system. System is being executed by the officers or the people.
You do realize, Mr. Kemchand Sharma, even as you argue with me on this, while this is not the focus of tonight's debate, but even as you insist in arguing with me on this, there is a massive Pegasus case that's going on, and the Supreme Court has ordered an investigation there. So let's not talk about legal and illegal surveillance yet. Let's wait till what comes out of that committee's probe, and then we'll debate it for sure. NS Nappinai, I wanted to make a point earlier. Yes, go ahead, please.
Actually, the last bit which you mentioned is what I wanted to say, Tanvi, that the debate seems to have moved very far away from the way we started with respect to fake news and hate speech and into the surveillance mode. And the reason I wanted to make this point is also to bring back the focus on the three things that you had summarized in terms of where does the solution lie. And I wanted to bring it back to this debate. When you asked about, is it in the hands of the government or the social media platform, et cetera, I just wanted to emphasize that we are not talking about either or here. Mm. We are talking about a cumulative process where all stakeholders need to come together to be able to contribute to the solution. The first and, of course, the best suited for providing a solution would be the social media platform themselves, and parallelly also would the government be in a good position. The second aspect of it is, it can't always be only with the danda. It's not like only where there is something which says that I will penalize you if you don't do something that a social media platform has to do. In the digression, there was a lot of talk about the new intermediary guidelines and the penalties under it, whether it's valid or not, etc. But what happened despite even those stringent provisions, there were social media platforms which did not comply. So what we need today is effective solutions, mm-hmm. which are workable solutions, which can be implemented immediately. Because we are really talking about the loss of lives here. Let us not trivialize that. Let us not brush aside the main reason why it's important to ensure that fake news and hate speech do not happen on social media platforms. And that is primarily to save lives. And in that context, if there are laws or provisions that are needed within the parameters of the Parent Act, which can be implemented immediately, we should evaluate that.
Right.
Responsible social media users, there has to be accountability in terms of the actual posts. Not one of us have really talked about the user angle.
Yeah.
Isn't it an individual user who is actually ultimately creating these conflicts, creating these loss of lives?
Well, ideally speaking, yes, Ms. Nappinai. Ideally speaking, there should be that kind of responsible behavior, but there isn't. It's the exact opposite of that. There is an intent to spread this kind of a thought, this kind of false narrative, or even hate. Maybe that person doesn't see it as hate, and I see it every day, the commentary, the responses that come even to us on various Twitter and Facebook platforms. My apologies to Pawan Duggal and Rahul Narayan, but I will not be able to come. You're completely out of time. I thank my guests for joining me on this conversation, various nuances that came out. And I will just summarize what most of them said to say, well, the accountability isn't that of a single entity, but it has to start off from the social media giants. And social media giants who have big plans and big ideas for their own business and future in this country shouldn't just see it by saying, oh, what is it that we can feed them every day as content? How do we keep them hooked on constantly 24/7. What is the content that they like, and let's give them more of that, and then not care about what it is that you're feeding people, because that's where the whole cycle of divisive content, provocative content, hateful content, false narratives, fake news actually begins. Anything that sounds like a great conspiracy is not true, but is a great conspiracy to get somebody hooked onto your Facebook page. That temptation has to be dealt with and said no to. And that only the social media giants can do, by bringing in systems, checks and balances at their front. The governments need to behave in an impartial manner when they crack down on such content and make the social media giants accountable, not just the ones they don't like, but across the board, all of them, domestic, international, left-leaning, right-leaning, irrespective of all of that. And then comes the accountability of the political parties and individuals themselves. Only then, maybe, to some extent, we will be able to deal with this problem. Thank you so much for joining us.